He borrowed for your business.
Yeah, I borrowed. Ryzen 5000 is like the king and the god of everything.
Do I need to update the BIOS? Okay guys, welcome back to Remote Time. So it has been a super long time. This is episode 2 of MG Talk Tech Show. Alright, it's been more than 1 year since we did this.
Actually, MG. Less. I distinctly remember the first episode was somewhere during the start of Circuit Breaker. So less than 1 year.
Okay, so we are back with this episode 2 MG Talk Tech Show. Why? Because we have some things deep in our hearts we want to tell you guys. We want to make it clear once and for all. Let's start with something very simple first. How did this channel start? Okay, I think that's my answer.
Yeah, that is actually for you to answer. But it started when this guy showed up at my door with no invitation.
I actually wanted to start a YouTube channel for a while. Then I required some form of tech things and tech knowledge. And it also happened that I required a new PC to do my video editing. So we went to Google and we saw we have, of course, everyone knows AS. DC, yeah, but we want to try something special and different.
Yeah.
And since Lavender is quite close to our previous office, and we just came by here and happened to see this guy.
Mm.
Yeah. One day after buying a PC, I just popped the question, not getting married. Yeah. Do we want to do a channel together?
Look, initial thought in my head was, this is an utterly crazy, stupid idea. Sounds like fun. Let's do it.
Yeah, like that. I was like, oh my god, is he regretting right now? Okay, so wow. It's been almost 2 years since we started together. So 2K plus subs and coming. Thank you guys. All right, let's now go on to, okay, let's do a very simple tanker question. If you are in the gunning of creating your own PC, building one yourself, probably have this in your mind. Is it better to build one from scratch, aka buy firsthand, or just buy something from Carousell, aka secondhand? So what's your thing on that?
So the answer to this is that both have pros and cons. If you're looking at firsthand, the biggest advantage is, of course, warranty. Provided you make sure that the parts that you buy are local stock with local warranty.
Yeah.
Alternative is that instead of buying the parts yourself individually, you buy your PC customized and fitted together and set up already from people like us. We provide 3 years of hardware warranty on the set itself. So basically, we will rectify and replace whatever parts that needs to be dealt with.
Yeah. Point of note, only hardware. Because why? We'll explain it in a later part of the video.
Yeah, that part.
Yes, yeah. It's quite a big gripe about that.
Yes.
Okay.
The upshot is you have assurance of warranty and support, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
What's the downside? Expensive. Anything that's brand new is gonna cost money.
Yeah, brother, Chanel is the same.
Yeah. Then of course, the people who buy secondhand. Pro is of course, price. Much more attractive than if you were to buy something equivalent brand new. Let's compare two GPUs. One that we can buy brand new today versus one that is in EOL. We have the RTX 2070 Super and the GTX 1080 Ti.
Oh.
An RTX 2070 Super market price brand new now will be about 700-750 SGD. But with that, you get 3 years of warranty. The 1080 Ti is basically a 2070 Super without the ray tracing.
Mm.
It was succeeded by the RTX 2080 and 2080 Ti in August 2018. And Nvidia, per their usual practice, once they introduce a new line of GPU, they just discontinue the previous one. It's a safe bet that any 1080 Ti you see running around is older than mid-2018. It's either A, the card is out of warranty, especially those that were bought at launch in August 2016, or they are almost coming up to the end of their warranty already. But the thing is, a 1080 Ti on the second-hand market today, you can probably pick one up for like SGD 300 to 400. So upshot with the 1080 Ti, yes, you get to save that few hundred dollars. Downside, either no warranty or not much of it left.
Of course, if you buy second-hand also, you don't know what you are in for the second-hand component.
Yeah, because chances are you have no idea what the previous owner did. Unless you're willing to go down into the nitty-gritty, especially for GPUs that have a mining history. And some of their previous owners are very good at covering up effect.
Yeah.
So that's one thing to take note. While all the sets I sell are brand new, my own set at home is a hogger-pogger of second-hand parts.
Yeah, don't worry, we'll talk to that
later. We'll talk to that later. Okay. Yeah.
So, next question. Question number two. Team Blue or Team Red? AMD versus Intel.
Yes, this is the eternal question for the last 30, 40 years. Yes, this is one battle that will never end on.
We don't want to disturb both camps today, but
we'll see which one has the worst pitchfox to flame us with. Okay, right about now, this is a very open-ended question.
Yes, because we're waiting for Intel's Rocket League.
Okay, but as of right now, if we take away Rocket League since it's not yet launched, on one end of the aisles, we have the AMD Ryzen line of CPUs. They have been proven to be quite fantastic for content creators.
Mm-hmm.
Cause for the price per dollar, they often offer more cores and threads, for example?
I think for the sake of this question, we just talk about the gaming parts, the Ryzen's and the more affordable Intel's instead of the Threadrippers and the Xeons.
I'll say for mid-range. Previously, before Ryzen 5000, Intel had the edge in gaming. And only if, let's say, you took that i5 and you plonked a top-tier GPU at that time, like a 2080 Ti right next to it, then you can probably see a difference between the Intel Core i5 and the AMD Ryzen 5 equivalent, which would have been the 3600.
Single-core performance.
Yeah, because most games depend a lot on single-core performance, which explains why Intel likes to drag out CSGO in this marketing material.
Mentioned many times.
Yes, a lot. But Ryzen 5000 has come in and changed the picture quite a fair bit. Now, Ryzen 5000 is like the king and the god of... Ryzen 5000 is like the king and the god of everything. It does content creation, it does gaming, it does everything. But that aside, there are some level of task where Intel CPUs do have an edge. One of which is if you're an Adobe user. Or to be more specific, you use Adobe Premiere.
Yeah.
Adobe Premiere and some other applications, they can use the Intel iGPU, the onboard GPU, as a encoder, that kind of things, to, I don't know,
speed up
the compression and export process.
Yeah, correct.
So on a Ryzen CPU without this, it's basically brute force. You're using all the core, all the threads, it's software thrown all the way. On the Intel CPU, you get a little bit of hardware acceleration along the way, complements of that Intel onboard GPU. So in Premiere, it does have an advantage. If you know your application specifically uses the AVX instruction sets, Intel has the edge because Intel came up with AVX first. But other than these two specific scenarios, I'll say at the mid-range, if you can get the Ryzen 5 5600X, get that one, don't think about it. Yeah. But if you can't get that, for gaming-wise, it's a toss-up between the Ryzen 5 3600, 3600X, that gang, and the Intel Core i5 10400, that range. You can't go wrong with either.
Yeah.
If you're a fan of Intel, pick the Intel. If you're a fan of AMD, pick the AMD.
Yeah, so there's no conclusive answer to this.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go back to something more casual. Probably are thinking, we have a PC builder here, we have a content creator here. What kind of PCs are we actually running?
I'm embarrassed to show mine. It's in a perpetual state of work in progress.
At least you got something better than mine. You start first.
I'm currently riding AMD Ryzen 5 2600X. No fancy liquid cooling on it. It's got the Rave Prism sitting on it because I happen to have it spare on the shelf. Motherboard also isn't very fancy. It's MSI X470 Gaming Plus. 16 gigs of G-Skills Trident Z Royals. That's the only thing in there that's shiny, by the way.
I don't know why.
I don't know why I spend that money. GPU-wise, that's an interesting story because from about 2 years ago, I had this Sapphire RX Vega 64 Nitro. I had it liquid cooled. Then I had a very bad accident with it and I blew up the card. And the kind folks at the Sapphire distributor, it starts with the letter C, kindly told me that due to me putting the water block, I voided my warranty. So RIP Vega 64.
Yeah.
Right now I'm using an RX 5700 XT blower that I borrowed from our office storeroom.
You borrowed from your office
storeroom? Yeah, I borrowed. Yeah, it's because actually the thing was, I've been waiting for Big Navi for quite a while. The only thing is, now the Big Navi is actually launched, the problem is, if I can find one piece, it goes to a customer first. So until the stock situation with Big Navi normalizes, it's that borrowed 5700 XT for me.
Alright, my turn. I'm also running a 3600X, but I'm still currently running on B450, 16 gigs of FlareX. Space definitely running out. I won't bother you how much SSD and HDD I have, but it's definitely running out. GPU, 1070 Ti, man. 1070 Ti. But I still managed to get pretty okay frames, no RTX on Cyberpunk 2077, so still okay. For one, I definitely need to upgrade my CPU and my GPU and my space for my work needs. So one day maybe. So you're thinking that, as a PC builder,
we'll come up with something.
PC builder, content creator, you see all of these MSI, Supremex, and whatever
that you're don't get to keep them. Yeah, we don't get to keep them.
It's not
contrary to popular belief.
Yeah, maybe one day when we grow bigger, maybe these brands will allow us to keep them. But as for now, this is what we have. Right now, let's go on to another tech question. Can you use different kind of RAMs on your motherboard?
Yes, very common problem. Like, let's say, for example, today you buy a brand new PC. You decided to stick on a 16 gig kit of G-Skills Trident Z Neos. So you have four RAM slots. So two of them is taken up by this 8GB x2. Let's say 2 years from now, you decide that due to various reasons, maybe requirements, that kind of thing, that 16 gig ain't gonna cut it for you
anymore.
Problem is that you can't seem to find that exact kit anymore. Yeah. So what's gonna happen in this case? The answer to this would depend. If let's say both kits have different timings and frequency, in this scenario, what should you do? One thing would be, I will not advise you to use the XMP. Because obviously, both pairs of RAM, the XMP profiles will be different. Don't use XMP, go manual. If you have to go manual, that means you have to set the frequency, test latency, or the timings, all that yourself. Can get a little bit technical, but it's actually not really that technical once you get the hang of it. The general rule of thumb is that you try to clock it down to the slower of the two pairs. Yeah, so since they are both the same CL, but one of them the frequency is lower than the other, so you set it to that same CL but that lower frequency.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think that applies the same with different kind of brands.
Different brands, again, okay, if they are same timing. I would then also advise, go into BIOS, manually set the timing to whatever it is the timing that these guys are XRP certified for.
Yeah, but ultimately a better choice would be to use the same brand, the same timing, and the same frequency for all the RAM.
Yeah, if you can get that, that's the ideal scenario. But do take note that on desktop systems, that means dual channel systems like let's say mainstream Ryzen, Intel Core architecture, you will notice more often than not, especially if your initial first pair is very fast RAM.
Yes.
Like let's say the really expensive Corsair 4000 MHz here, 18.
A vengeance.
So the thing is, the way the RAM controllers and all that work is that while often they are capable of this very high speed, due to the complications in having to talk to two separate pairs, very often when you put a second pair in, you will not be able to set to this
4000.
This very high speed and or run stable. It's either A, the set will just cold boot on you because it can't handle the RAM at all, or you'll start up into the set will run into Windows, but you'll get blue screens everywhere. So do take note of that. There are certain scenarios where you can run very high speed on one pair, but you're forced to manually clock down to a lower speed when you run two. Case in point, AMD Ryzen, even for Ryzen 5000, we can run pretty high speeds when you only have one pair. But getting it to run two pairs on anything higher than 3200 MHz is a case of it can be done, but stability may be a question. Why? Actually, Ryzen 3000 and Ryzen 5000 specs, the rated DRAM clock speed is 3200 MHz. So if you run all four sticks on Ryzen, the safe and secure speed is 3200, because that's the spec on paper.
Okay, cool. Talking about that, we're going to do a RAM guide, a RAM test video very soon, so make sure to come back to that. So next question, also related to PC building, should you go to a physical store or should you get your parts online? So we're going to talk about this in both the Singaporean as well as the international context. So what is your thought on that one?
Okay, based on my years of experience, if we talk about in the Singapore context, for example, let's pick a random shop in Sim Lim Square. Let's say
PC Teams.
PC Teams, yeah. Nice guys. Okay, let's say they have an item for sale on Lazada and it's listed at $100. So would it be cheaper if you actually went down to the shop and bargained your way down? The answer is yes, to a certain extent. But first, let me explain to you how these online platforms usually work. Using the Lazada example again, merchant fee that they get percentage is 3%.
Yes.
So in the $100 item example, every time somebody clicks that button and buys something for $100, $3 goes to Lazada. So from a business point of view, if you went down to the shop itself and you tell them, look, I got $98 in cash, they might probably jolly well accept it. Because at the end of the day, it's a net gain for him.
Yes, there's no merchant fee, there's no credit card fee.
That's why. Usually, on a rule of thumb in Sim Lim Square, cash is king.
They may even waive your GST.
And some shops do that, although you might run into complications, especially if you need to claim things with GST registered vendor and all that thing. But that's a bit complicated, we'll leave that out. Having said that, however, there are some advantages to online. One of which is pertaining to heavy items.
Yes.
Can you imagine if let's say you bought a chassis?
Yes.
A big ass one like the Chrome Master C700M for example. Yeah, that big gorilla. Well, you could go down to the shop and get a discount on the case itself. More often than not, that few percent of discount could very well be wiped out by the fact that you probably have to
drive
or call a cab
or whatever,
or call a grab rather than take the train or the bus.
And even carrying the box out of the store requires a lot of work.
I've carried full tower casings on the MRT several times. It's not fun. Yeah, for certain things like this, it may probably be easier on your back.
Yes.
To just order it online and let the ninja van fella suffer.
Yeah, makes more sense.
Yeah, he's paid to do it. On the other side of the coin, it's an online listing. And anybody can put an online listing, especially in terms of like wherever the product is, a local product, and hence does it have local warranty, does it even have any warranty, etc, etc. If let's say you see the listing is by a physical shop, you should be pretty okay. But if it's from any of the others that you don't really know of where they are or who they are, you might want to be a little bit extra careful. Some parts can be parallel imported in from other regions, and if anything happens, warranty would be a problem.
Yes.
So I would like to take this opportunity though to correct one misconception, which is a very special case known as Amazon Singapore.
Ah, yes.
Yes, that one.
Yeah.
There's a lot of IT enthusiasts in Singapore. No, the Ryzen 5000 stock situation in Singapore is very bad. So if you're a customer looking for, let's say, a 5600X, 5800X, or 5900X, that kind of thing, then you go on Amazon Singapore and you see a listing for 5900X and it's in stock. Mm. So you think, yeah, this is awesome. Since it's Amazon Singapore, so you kind of like think in your head that it's Singapore warranty.
Local warranty.
Local warranty.
Yeah, yeah.
I have checked with some people in the AMD Singapore office, and what they have told me is that for units on Amazon Singapore, fulfilled by Amazon Singapore, those are not local units.
Hmm.
So therefore, compared to the ones which you typically buy in official retail, those have official local support, which means that you go to either of the two official distributors, which is Corbell and or Convergent. If there's anything wrong with CPU, you just bring the CPU to them, and if the fault is there, they'll probably replace the CPU on the warranty.
Yeah, one-on-one exchange.
Unless you broke the pin, in which case you're out of luck.
Yeah.
On the other end, if you buy one of the Amazon Singapore units, for those the warranty is from another region, which is not to say that they don't have warranty. It's just that it's considered like international warranty. And I just handled a case with a customer who had the RMA Threadripper 3990X, the really expensive 64 core unit, which he bought off Amazon. The process is quite tedious, which requires you to submit a form online on the AMD website, which is okay.
Yep.
Then they will ask you to send the 40 item back to a certain address.
Mm-hmm.
After that, you wait for them to diagnose, and then the replacement unit comes back. This customer of mine with the 390X has told me that the whole process from starting the RMA to actually having the replacement unit was 1 month.
Wow.
So if you're going to buy one of these units, I mean, if you see it's a great deal, go ahead. Just be careful and know that if you're going to take one from here, this is the drawback. And then I think somebody also did ask me, why the heck is that the case? The only theory, honestly, that I can think of is that Jim Bezos probably buys all of them in stock. And what Amazon does is just take this big pile of stock in the US, throw it around the world.
Yeah.
Which is why even though it's sitting in a Singapore warehouse,
yes,
it's not Singapore warranty.
Yeah, it's still American.
Yeah, this is my theory. Yeah. If anybody knows anything else or more details on this, please do let me know. Because all of this is just based on conjecture and speculation on my part.
Yes, so that's for Singapore. We're going to talk a bit on the overseas side because we're not very sure what is it like for you guys over there, but we assume the distance between your house and maybe, let's say, Best Buy Micro Center can be at least 3-4 hours drive apart. So maybe from this point of view, perhaps buying online will be a better choice for you guys.
Okay, I think based on things I know from some of our neighbors, like Malaysia, Indonesia especially, buying your parts online, either brand new or second hand.
Yep.
That's generally the case. The bigger the distance, the more popular and viable online shopping becomes. So that was quite a rant. Hope that answers your questions.
So next question, we also get very often in our comments, can my motherboard work with Ryzen 5000? Do I need to update the BIOS?
Now, according to the AMD press release that time, the 500 series of motherboards, which consists of A520, B550, and X570,
yep,
Ryzen 5000 support will be there. You just update to the latest BIOS, take the Ryzen 5000 CPU, plunk in there, and you're done.
Mm.
It works.
Mm.
When we get to the older fellas,
the 400 motherboards.
So from what I've seen so far, the motherboard fellas have given some priority to updating the current gen boards that they're selling in the shops right now. Now they're going back to slowly updating the previous gen boards, which are no longer for sale, the B450 and the X470 models. So as to the release schedule, do check with your motherboard manufacturer as well as that specific model. But from what I've seen from MSI, just to quote an example, all those B450 and the S470 with the Max moniker at the end have already gotten the update. Older revisions, the one without the Max at the end, the update is coming soon.
Yeah, that's only for MSI. So for example, other brands like ASUS and Gigabyte,
check with them.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
As for all the other motherboards,
the 300 series.
Wow, 300 series B350, X370, A320. I think you're out of luck and it's probably for a good reason. Even if the BIOS update was available, I probably wouldn't highly recommend using them for Ryzen 5000.
Yeah, it could be unstable.
Yeah, the differences in design between the first gen Ryzen boards and the current one is just catered to Ryzen 5000. The difference is simply too great.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
Cool. I hope that answers the question. So, okay, that's so much information for one. Let's go on to something more chill. Okay, so next, well, in relation to our question, the PC you're currently using, if we could upgrade, what components we want to go for?
What components would I want to go for? My home PC is for gaming. The other 20% is watching cat videos on YouTube.
Meow.
Meow. So, the 2600X with 6 core 12 threads has done fine for me. I've never been in any position where I actually needed more cores than that. So, if I were to look at an upgrade, I'd probably be looking at changing my 2600X to a 5600X. Changing out my X470 motherboard might be optional. I mean, PCIe 4 for me is nice to have, but it's not really a dying need. GPU from the 5600 XT, like I mentioned earlier, I'm looking at one of the big Navis, at least like a 6800 XT.
Are you running any PCIe 4 SSDs?
No, all my SSDs are all like entry level ones.
Okay.
To be rather frank, the way I use the set, SSD read write speeds has never been one of my priorities.
Okay, cool. Alright, so for myself, definitely looking at maybe the Ryzen 5000 or whatever is coming next. B450 definitely, I need to go up from there, because if I want to go Ryzen 5000, I'm B450. Even though it's a BIOS update, but I don't think it's the way to go. Because
in your case it's quite completely different, because the thing is, doing video work in general, you want multiple SSDs and all that, so you probably want to move on to a motherboard with multiple NVMe SSD slots, maybe the X570 Unify or Ace from MSI.
As for GPU, I was thinking about the big Navi and maybe 3080, 3090, but that's also very expensive. So maybe let's see this year what new things to both red and green come out. So we don't know yet.
In your case, you should stick with Nvidia, because the applications that you run, like Premiere or Lea, they've all been optimized for the green team.
One day, maybe both of us want to do live streaming, so we definitely need an upgrade for that one.
Yeah.
Alright, so we are down to our last question. People may be asking, why have we not done any water cooling build on our channel or in Typhoon systems?
That's a very good question. I think we're a bit of an oddball in this field. Every one of our competitors has gotten around to doing up some custom loops with the fancy hard tubing and all that for their customers.
Mm-hmm.
In our brand's history, we have done exactly one custom loop. That one was a story from long ago. The guy commissioned the rig from some brand in Australia, which I'll not name who, got the set shipped over to Singapore, and they just basically went MIA on him when the loop started having problems. So we were basically engaged by the customer to fix all the problems.
Yeah, correct.
I do agree that all-in-one liquid coolers and custom loops, when you do them up properly and you have a reason for them being there, yes, they are great. They look awesome. Why we do not do them? Number one, a lot of our customers and clients are in the professional design field, that kind of thing. Downtime due to hardware failure is always a concern.
Yes.
In engineering logic, for these customers especially, the simplest is always
the best.
The best. So for these customers, we will tend to go for, let's say if it's a multi-GPU setup, leave it with the default blowers on them, rather than get other GPUs and then put water blocks on them.
Yep.
Our approach is we stick with air for the GPU. For the CPU, we are also quite big fan of big air coolers. And this doctrine, for lack of a better word, has kind of extended into our consumer PC builds. We don't see the point in shoving in liquid cooling for the sake of just telling people that your set has liquid cooling. Yeah, if you're going to put a liquid cooling solution into your set over an air, it has to be for certain and specific reasons. For example, a 240mm radiator is always better than even the biggest air cooler. That one definitely I will give. But then, the downside is always, if let's say that AIO, the pump, fails, is it covered under warranty? Sure, but I have to dismantle and take out that entire AIO unit and get it replaced. This will take considerably more time. If it's a custom loop, anything goes wrong, oh boy. Yeah, because first you have to drain the loop, then you have to dismantle the loop,
scrub the loop.
Then you can get to diagnosing which of the parts is the one causing all the problems. With all these complications that can happen, we've decided that the simplest is the best.
Yeah, but that's not to say that we may not do a custom loop here on our channel. Maybe one day we would, I don't know. But
yes, corner down there, somebody sent us a very nice present. I'm actually looking forward to putting it together. What is it? Stay tuned.
Yeah.
I think you'll probably make an appearance on a certain oven that's gonna be turning up soon.
Yep, I think you guys know which one is it. Yeah. And so with that, this is episode 2 of MG Talk Tech Show. Hope you guys learned a lot today. Apologize if we fail to answer your questions, especially those very technical ones. We will answer them to you one by one. Don't worry.
Yes, and there are a lot of them.
So if you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up so that we know if we can carry on with episode 3, 4, 5, or whatever. So with that, goodbye.